thank you again. We will start our special conversation. Why don't I ask Professor Popova Zhitun, who has judged many international competitions, including Chopin, and recently also Rubinstein. And so would you like to share any wisdom to our young students?
Competitions are really tough. I'm always suffering as a member of the juries because the all young people, they want to compete, and this is probably the only way to go a little bit out of this big crowd of really excellent pianists. There are so many nowadays, and everybody wants to earn his or her living by making concerts, and there are not so many concerts. I think this is not something what we can ignore. The competitions are a good way to take your place, but on the other hand, I always say to my students that to receive a prize at a competition shouldn't be the goal during practicing and working on the pieces. Actually, our goal should be to play as beautiful as possible and to express the composer's ideas and in your own way to be yourself in a way, and not to think about winning or not winning the competition, because when we are concentrated on our play only to be beautiful, then we are the way to communicate with the listeners is probably to say the truth. If this truth is your own truth, that then you are convincing. And if you try to please the jury members or try to guess which option would be better for this or that jury, is not quite the good way of really expressing your inner understanding of the piece. So if somebody wants to be original and to make the things other ways than it is written, or than his understanding of the things, is not a good way. So success at a competition, it's like a bonus, not a goal. It's like your side effect, I would say. And this works. I think this is the only way to convince the jury members, if you are really sincere and honest. What else? The results are always, especially the Chopin competition. I have been there 3 times, and it was never that all the jury agreed about the ranking list, because the juries are also different people. So if you see the ranking and you think the first was the best, is not really the truth. The first was he gained the most number of admirer, but not that he was the best, because another jury could give another result. So it's not a one dimension. it's not about speed or height or I don't know, like in sports. There are so many aspects of the performance that different listener appreciate different sides of this interpretation. So to draw thought that I was second, so I'm not that good. It's not really what the conclusion is that I have to try to another competition. And usually, I think many of these young pianists, they meet at different competitions. They even get friends because this is one generation, and they appear here and there and then, and finally they become friends because this is their time. And you have a good repertoire, a rich repertoire, for sure. You have to be operating with older pieces, not to learn the pieces just before the competition, and then try here and there, and sometimes the results are disappointing, and other time they can be successful. And if not, what you gain really is the work on the pieces. It's you're getting more and more experience, more and more mature, and this is the real award, I think, after a competition. It's also that people make progress not only until 30, they are all the time developing, and certain pianists who didn't make great success during the Chopin competition, for example, they became after really well-known pianists because they didn't give up. They still tried because they loved music, simply. The competitions were not their goal. They wanted, of course, to be there, to make this experience, but after 30 years, you can develop and develop, and I think until the end of life, because this is material we never can say that it is done. Year later, and you're another person, and you see there are other things also interesting, and you perform the old repertoire in a quite a fresh and new way. So this is important to remember that competitions are a good experience, but it's not the end of the world. So this is probably my wisdom.
And I got this and I got that, but the big difference is the number of people who are trying to get in and have to pass the this
Could you alter
sort of
him well?
This entrance video or recording of some sort. I think that is a big difference. And we always used to say it was hardest to get past the first round because there were so many, but now it's hardest to get into the first round.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah.
And you just do your best, you know. Take preparing for competitions very, very seriously. And try to play your best. Be a good colleague to the other people who are competing. Make friends, look after them. And they, some of my best friends in music came from competitions. We were all in the same horrible situation together. And, well, we were, you know, and strange things can happen. People say, oh, I say, well, why did you invite me here? And she said, oh, my daughter was in the Busoni competition with you. She said you were nice. I didn't say I was a good pianist. She just said I was nice. And so that was a recital in Bilbao, and I always remember why I got it. But it does broaden your horizons, like Professor Auer was saying. And good things can come from it, particularly if you work very hard and prepare well. And also, don't lose your sense of humour. It may not. It may not work out this time. But I remember the year I got the second prize in Paloma Rocher, which is a good competition in Spain. Well, it was only a couple of months after I was knocked out in the first round of another one. So one competition told me that I wasn't worth hearing again. And then the next was a good competition with concerts for the second prize winner and money and so on. So you just keep on. You don't say that it's not an exam. You know, you're not going to get professional qualifications from competitions. But it's just you're hoping for a chance to make life different.
More questions? Yes.
I'd like to ask, the professor, are you've been studying with many very great, the greatest musicians of your ages, like Kemp and Kachin and Levin. I don't know how to spell, I cannot pronounce it in English. I mean, Levin, the Russian pianist. So, how about the experience to study from these great people? They from different countries and from different musician conditions and their playing techniques. How do they influence you?
I didn't.
She's saying that Edward, you studied with Madame Levine, Russian,
yeah.
And Kemp, German,
yeah.
And Julius Kachin, American, who was in Paris. And how did he? How did they teach you? And how did you learn?
Yeah, well, to be perfectly truthful, Julius Kachin was, in my opinion, my most helpful, the teacher from whom I learned the most, whom I learned the best things from, not only from what he specifically tried to teach me, but what I learned from hearing him play and from the way he talked about things. An unbelievably brilliant man who had a wide range of interests and well, and
10 lessons or something, or 12.
Yeah, that's true.
During his Paris stay, it's not every week a lot, but about 10, 12, right?
Yes. He was a very, very strong influence on me. Of course, I studied with Madame Levine for a longer time, so the influence was also very, and I was younger, so the influence was very good too. She was a very gentle teacher, and she didn't constantly try to make me into something that I wasn't. She was very flexible teacher in that way.
One time, Edward was playing a performance class, and he made a mistake. You made a mistake.
I can't remember.
You made a mistake.
Me?
He made a, yeah. And he said,
"Okay,
rats."
Yeah. One of those things that you.
He still does that when he makes a mistake. It's ouch or something.
Well, anyhow, this was in a master class led by Mrs. Levine, and I hit a nasty wrong note, and I said rat, just under my breath. And after I'd finished playing, she said, "Very fine, she said, idiot. Did I hear you say something? Rats?" "Do not speak when you play."
I wanted to add something. Something what happens also, especially in big competitions, that certain people are so intense as an artist that other agents or people who can promote them ask them later to give tours or ask them for concerts, although they didn't got a prize. So was the case with a very famous
Pogorelic.
Yes,
he didn't get the prize, but
yes, he didn't get the prize. But this is a very famous case. But also Andrzejewski was at the Leeds competition, and he didn't get the prize, and he became very famous because. Other very influential people noticed that he's something very special, and never lose your faith that something can happen. Always try only to play as beautifully as possible, and don't care about the rest.
Yeah, that's the secret right there. I just. play as though your life depended on it, as beautifully as you possibly can.
Always remembering that your life doesn't depend.
More questions?
Is that a hand up or is it a hand?
Well.
Development, and also quite important for your music to be interested in many things about life, so that your life is as rich as possible. Because if you're sitting there and playing notes better than anybody else, it doesn't amount to anything finally.
Well, I guess now I have the mic. So, and also in terms of repertoire, so I actually agree with what Professor Auer just said. You try to enrich your life as much as possible, so it's not just about piano. And I'm so glad to see that in this workshop, you guys, you know, from the first day you don't know each other, and then now you get to be friends, and you come support each other, so that's great. I mean, pianists, we're all lonely, we're not like, you know, the other instrumentalists that we get to play in orchestras and, you know, share the same class. So to be competition is also about like a sharing experience. So you want to be seen, you want to be heard, but you also want to, you know, see and, you know, hear each other. So you learn from each other, so you know actually how good or bad you are. Like, you know, you know where the benchmark is, and you know what to work for, right? And also, don't always limit yourself, and, you know, just try to give yourself as much to explore. You know, there are so many possibilities out there, you know, in terms of repertoire, in terms of, you know, passion outside music. So, yeah, so explore life to the fullest. And I think that helps music and helps your playing and how you experience, you know, music on stage and off stage.
Any more questions?
I just wanted to say that before I had gone to any of these competitions, I somehow imagined that there was a lot of anger among the contestants. I want to win over him, and I want to. And it turned out that everybody is generally, you get to know each other a little bit, and your competitors are your allies at the same time. In the finals of the Brussels Queen Elizabeth competition, when we have a piece that was specially written for the competition, and there was somebody was able to get a radio in, and they were listening to my performance of this new piece, and of course not in the, oh, I hope he messes up, really rather the opposite. In fact, there was one place where I did have a little trouble, and one of my colleagues crossed herself. She was so, yeah. Oh my God. So everybody becomes you're on the same side.
Well, okay, yes.
Can you say whether competitions are necessary to make a career, or whether there are other ways to develop a career?
Of course, there are a few other ways, but most of the people find that the competition works the best. I'm not going to say anything more about it.
It's the most popular way are the competitions, but nowadays probably. Also, if you record a lot and you let it be in YouTube, you can be also heard by influential people. Sometimes if you're sure that you're very special and you find a sponsor to buy the hall and to invite important people who will write after reviews. But I think all these other ways are not so available for everybody, and that's why the competitions are so popular now. Nowadays, over 500 people are applying for the big competitions. Almost around 300 and 500. 500 is for Chopin competition, but I remember that for Tel Aviv there were also more than 300 applications. So if you competition is already a success. I see now that people are writing in their CVs that he took part in this and that competition, and this is mentioned as a success. Before we wrote at least semifinalist or something like this. Now is to be in the first round and kicked out. It's also a success. if we think about the Chopin competition, there are two competitions before, because out of these 500 are chosen on the recordings 180, and then from this 180 who are coming to Warsaw to play for half an hour are chosen only 80. So there are two competitions before, and then four stages of that. So the prize winner has won six competitions before, something like this.
It depends, a lot depends on how you present the facts, too. There was a, I don't know who this was anymore, his name, but his name was Abramovitz or something like that, which came very close to the beginning of the alphabet, and he was eliminated in the first round. I don't know what competition. He was eliminated in the first round, and he wrote back in Moscow, because it's in Tchaikovsky. He wrote in his bio, "Finished first in Moscow."
We should be very creative to how to promote ourselves. Okay, since you asked a few questions, okay, now let's go to somebody else to comment. Okay, James?
To what degree does choice of repertoire become a matter of significance in competitions?
Very good question, and difficult to answer. If your repertoire is altogether ordinary, and you take the most popular Beethoven sonata, the most popular, you are less likely to stand out. But of course, if you choose a fascinating and unusual repertoire, if you don't play it splendidly, then you also are nowhere. But I think I would say that it's very important, but it's important in a personal way, that you should play the music that you yourself find attractive, and everybody tells you that you play that especially well, then that's a good choice.
And don't try to impress juries. Mm-hmm. They're older, and they've heard it all before. It's really important, this one. It doesn't, the program doesn't impress, it's the playing that impresses.
And
that really is important. And what you said about asking other people their opinions, I haven't taught a lot. You know, you get students who say, "Oh no, I want to play such and such." And I say, "Oh no, please don't." Because you know perfectly well it's not going to be fantastically good. This is not going to, I want to. And the fight always ends, you know, so, oh my God, whatever. But it is very important to take advice on your playing.
Even if you don't like it.
Even if you don't like it, and it doesn't just have to be one person. Play for several people and say, you know, what do you think? When Gilels, the great Russian pianist, Emil Gilels, he won the first Brussels competition in 1938, something like that, 38. And there was almost a competition in the conservatory in Moscow. Should he play the Liszt sonata, or should he play the Chopin B flat minor sonata? And he was out of it, you know, everybody was Neuhaus, it was just saying, what do you think? Is Emil Chopin sonata good enough, or the Liszt sonata?
was winning Brazil and Tchaikovsky and so on. Nowadays, it's very difficult to become the best pianist in the world. I think there is nothing like this. So he's bringing a lot. I'm not following it really very thoroughly, his career. I know that he's playing a lot in Japan and a lot in the United States, but where exactly? I don't know. For sure, he can make his living by giving concerts. Nevertheless, he started to work at our academy 2 years ago, but not as a regular teacher. He makes only twice in a year workshops, but he's on the side of our academy. I wanted to tell you about another of my students who won the 4th prize at the last competition. This was a very interesting boy who came to my class, and our first meeting, he said, "Don't worry, I'm not going to prepare for the Chopin competition." I said, "Oh, how nice." Lucky to have you. And he was very good, and he won certain competitions here I forgot the name, not Horns, but another one quite big in the United States, then another one in the top of the world in Scandinavia somewhere. But nevertheless, he didn't get a lot of concerts. So before the Chopin competition, Jakub Kuschnik. And he said to me, "You know, I'm playing these competitions abroad, and in Poland nobody knows about me. Probably I should try the Chopin competition. Even if I get to the competition in October, it will be already a success, and in Poland I will be more known, and I will be better career in Poland." So I said, "Okay, let's prepare for the Chopin competition." And he started, and he was qualified to the pre-selection round. And from the pre-selection round, he was qualified for the Chopin competition in October. Then he passed to the second stage, and it was already quite logical. He played very well. But when he passed to the third stage, he became to be quite terrified. And he thought, "Oh God, I have something like this I haven't expected, but okay, I'll play the third round." And when he got qualified for the fourth, for the finals, he said, he was really, it's not true, what are you saying? It's impossible. He really wanted only to become a little more well-known in Poland, and he tried to do his best. And finally, he became the only Polish pianist with a 4th quite a good prize at the competition without planning this. This is what I said at the very beginning. Try to do your best, and now he's like a globetrotter all over the world that he's playing. And additionally, he became the biggest money because he was the only one Polish. So this, you never know. It's simply, I always say the biggest benefit is the preparation for the competition. Because if you're trying to prepare for a competition, you work much more detailed, much more profound. You read a lot, you listen a lot, and this is what you will have for the rest of your life, not only the competition.
Any more questions?
Yes.
What are your thoughts on holding up your reputation should anyone be successful at distinguishing themselves in a competition afterwards?
I don't quite understand.
What's your question?
If you get concerts after a competition, How do you go about keeping up the same level that audiences expect from their performance?
Very hard. That is what you have to know before you start for the competition, because the life of a prize winner of such a big competition like Chopin competition is really hard. And this looks like before the competition it's oh my god, I'm the god, and so, but then this traveling all over the world, every time the audience is expecting you will be at your top, but you're a human being, and it can end once you have not such a wonderful concert, then all the world knows. Knows in a few hours, everybody on the world knows that this concert was a bad one. If you play good, so it's natural. Nobody's talking about it's unpleasant to think about this, but nevertheless, I think it's a tough life, but on the other hand, very special life. If somebody wants this, why not? Let's try, but you have to refuse from many other things, very pleasant things in life. This is the cost of it. If you think about Polini or Horowitz, they couldn't stand actually this life for a longer time. They had to go to a hospital and to cure a little bit. Cycling is really very loading.
I think, you know, a different sort of competition starts after you've won your first prize winner. Then you're out in the big wide world, and all the other people who are already there, you're in competition with them. I think it's a case of be careful what you wish for, because it isn't just do what you want to do after you become Panini or Argerich or something like that. It's hard. And you need to be very tough. And love music. I mean, that's the most important thing in the whole thing. Somebody, it was Richard Good who got good management in the States when he was quite young. And he rang Rudolf Serkin and said, well, what should I do? I'm frightened. And Serkin just said, love music more. And that's all he said. And I think it's actually rather profound and wonderful advice. You know?
I remember also a friend of mine, a very famous teacher, Ari Vardi, said to me, the most difficult competition is the competition you have with yourself. And this is a competition, it lasts all your life. And I think this is also true. Because we are always willing to be better and better, and this is like competition with ourselves.
Anybody else?
Yeah, let's take one more question. Oh, after this, probably some of our students or competitors or who played in a Friday, Saturday, they might want some comments. So if you don't mind, just giving them. So
yeah.
after this conversation. Okay. Oh, let's go Christian first, okay?
In terms of what you just mentioned, Professor, when you feel yourself kind of getting in your own way, what are some ways that you may get out of a rut if you're kind of stuck?
When you are in your own competition, so you're always expecting someone you're not. So when you are struggling with your own competition, what are the ways
what are some things that you can...
But this is the way we are developing, actually. We set always a little higher the level, and we try to struggle and to achieve this, and then a little higher and higher. This is the competition. When I, your question was when I cannot get to this, then I'm frustrated. But I don't allow myself to be too long frustrated. So after 2-3 days, making a little hands right here, yeah, heart. Never give up. It's because I love music. It's the love of music is probably on the base of all this struggling.
Okay, one more? Azalea, you had one more question.
Yeah, it was just, what's your most memorable experience judging a competition?
From your judging,
anybody
was memorable? Well, I can share that I'm not talking about what I, when I judged. Actually, I just followed Edward. That was the first time I met Katarzyna in 2015. There's an Asian Chopin competition. So there were many wonderful judges, Katarzyna, Edward, Dan Paisong, Kevin Kenner, Paletini, and many wonderful judges. And what was so wonderful for me that since I wasn't a competitor, I wasn't a judge, I'm just a guest, but they were very nice that I was always included in the judges' meals together. So I was able to hear what they're talking about. But it was so touching that many people still talk about, after the result has announced, after the first round, the second round, they still talk about what they heard. Whether this person passed or not passed, they talk about what they heard. And what was so good, what was so touching, or what could have been a little better, and still all about the music. And like all of us, when we hear the result, if I don't pass, you know, it hurts so much. And I sense that the judges also go through very, very sincere involvement. So I, in a first-hand I experienced, judges are sincerely involved. They're not usually happy because they always choose some people in next round and not. But so yeah, at the end of the competition, we just get very simple result, but it's much more. So as we heard, in the next time, we don't know where, how much far we can go. So we should, if you love music, you should not stop. I have to really focus on music. So I, no,
like today, or when I watch Chopin competition live or Tchaikovsky, then I ask, how was your competition? Were you not nervous? He always answers, I was so concentrated on my music, I wasn't. So the reason I keep asking is because if I were his position, I would be just trembling so much. But I'm learning that you are, one can be really fast on music. I think that can be that has to be a very important message, at least I'm learning over and over again. And also, you know what, I also remember, judges do regret. No? One time, Edward, I think it's okay to share.
I don't know what it is.
Yeah, in 1993, in Tchaikovsky, the result was prize winners, but no first prize. The second prize winner is essentially the first prize winner, but the judges decided not to give the first prize. And so Lugansky got second prize, but there was no first prize. So.
And it was a vote of, a vote of 6-5 in the jury. Five wanted him to have a first prize, 6 wanted him to not have a first prize. For better or for worse, I was one of the 6. And the rest of my little existence, although he really has been making just a fine career, thank you very much, without my help. but it always bothered me.
He regrets very much. So, I think.
So, being uncharitable is something that you can sometimes stumble along for a long time without.
But the lesson is, he could have won the first prize. Yes, second prize is just amazing too, but. And Edward regrets that quite a bit. But one should not just locked into one just way because of the result.
I guess it's also a perfect example of what Katarzyna was saying, right? Like, you know, people actually keep growing after competitions.
Yeah, keep growing, yeah. So when I find Lugansky's Etude Tableau, and when I listen to it, he says, oh, I'm so sorry that I
too bad.
Any memorable judging moment? Maybe a lot.
No, it's always is confusing when you receive the results and you see that your types are in another order.
Right.
But you have to agree, because it's not only you to decide. And also this makes things a little easier, because why you? Probably another one of these 6 can
read. Right.
You never know, but usually we agree about the first prize. It's a majority in the Chopin competition. There is first of all is voting about do we have a first prize or not. Because there were 2 competitions, one after another, without first prize. And this was a disaster, because actually always is somebody the best. But they decided not to give the first prize. Once it can happen, but the second time, and the Chopin competition started to be not so desirable for the young people, because they thought, oh, what do they want, actually? They are not getting the first prize. So then came this Chinese boy. He was very correct, perfect, and so on. They decided to give him the first prize. In other conditions, probably he wouldn't get after 2 competitions without first prize. So I personally, I luckily haven't had this situation like concerto. It was first time when he played the concerto with orchestra. And after he went to Tel Aviv first prize and Tchaikovsky first prize, it was okay with, but nevertheless, it was obvious that he's absolutely genius. But the pieces were not so excellent, were not ready. He was very young then. And I put him on the third place. It was the right order. So this is my confession about being a jury member. No,
I don't know whether you have something on your conscience.
No. On my conscience about that. No, I think you generally, I think people try to do the right thing in the heat of the moment, mm-hmm. and there is a lot of tension and heat in these competitions, in jury rooms and so on, and people feel very strongly, and perhaps the day after they think, I was a little bit overexcited or something. It can happen to everybody, but it happens.
I can't remember which competition this was, but I remember it's one with a few rounds, you know, like first round, second round, and then I remember this boy playing in the first round so beautifully, you know, everything was in control, and then he got into the second round, and then not so good. He couldn't really, because, you know, it's another set of repertoire, and, well, we didn't actually got to ask him, but he probably didn't think he would make it to the second round, or maybe he was just running out of time. He didn't really have time to learn properly the pieces for the second round. So he played really, you know, under level. So, you know, it's very sad, you know, we the jury members were very, very sad, you know, that he got so much potential. He could really make it to the final round, but, you know, he just didn't prepare himself well enough, so we just very sad to let him go, right, after the second round. So I thought, you know, it was also quite tricky, quite difficult that, you know, if you're preparing for a big competition, you have many rounds, many repertoire to cover. So be really prepared, because you don't know how far you will go.
Right.
Right. So don't expect too much, but don't underestimate yourself as well, because you might get on. And I think also, you know, to not just technically prepare ourselves, right, but, you know, also mentally, you have to prepare yourself for the many rounds to come. Just trust yourself, I guess. Yeah.
Anything to add?
No.
Okay. So we just spent about an hour. I'm sure this conversation will help you to think more or further questions. But so come back next year. We'll have more conversations. Anyway, okay. Thank you again so much. Beautiful performances today and participation with this interesting questions. Okay. Our next event is tomorrow at 10 o'clock.